Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In the last few segments, we've been talking all about the accounting cycle. We've talked about what it is, why it's important, and then we started going through each of the different elements of the cycle in detail. We've talked about doing journal entries. Yes, my favorite part. Doing adjusting entries, posting entries, doing trial balances. And now we get to go on and start the process of creating the financial statements. Now, most companies can go right into creating the financial statements right after doing their adjusted trial balance. But there are a few companies that have one other intermediate step before they can get into that financial statement process. And that's what we need to start off with, is that intermediate step, so that we're ready for those companies that need it. And the big question that determines whether or not we need to do this extra step is whether or not it's a perpetual or periodic inventory company. Now, normally, if we were in a class together, I'd ask you, what's the difference between perpetual and periodic inventory? But we don't have that option, so I guess I'll just explain it since I'm the only one here. The periodic inventory system is the old way of doing things. We keep track of inventory as it comes in, but not as it goes out. What we do, basically, is we have a count of the stuff that's on hand at the beginning of every period. And then, as we place orders, we write down the information as those orders come in. It's easy to count, it's right there. We verify that we've received what we had ordered, which we would have to do anyway to make sure we weren't being ripped off. And then, we put them on the shelves. Now, we don't keep track when inventory leaves the store. Instead, at the end of the year, we do inventory, which means we go through and count every single piece of inventory that we have on hand. It's a very long process. For those of you who haven't done inventory before, just to kind of give you a picture of what it's like, many years ago when I was in high school, a friend of mine talked me into going to do inventory with him at the place where he worked. He was a little behind and could get some extra hours. So he talked me into coming along with him one evening, and I went to the store and we counted stuff for hours and made notes of what we counted and what we found and how many there were on each rack, and it was a long evening. Come to think of it, he still owes me money for that. If he ever gets out of jail. No, take it back. He's out of jail. If they ever catch him, because he's on the run, I think, then I'm going to get my money back, I think. Somehow I'm going to have to find a way. Anyway, it was a long process, and when you're not getting paid for it, it gets even longer. But it takes a long time to count everything. So a lot of companies have switched gears from this periodic system where you gather all this information about what comes in, don't gather anything about what goes out, to one where you're keeping track of everything that comes in and goes out. And that's a perpetual system. We perpetually know, or always know, everything that's on hand. In a periodic system, you know what's come in, but you don't know what you've got until you do inventory. So what you do, basically, to figure out what you've sold is you go through and you calculate everything you've purchased, and then you subtract what you've got left, and whatever isn't there must have been sold. At least that's the assumption that you make. Perpetual system, you know what you sold at any time. It's in your cost of goods sold account. You've kept track of those journal entries every time you made a sale. So the next question is this one. Well, which one's more accurate? The perpetual system is more accurate. I can keep track of everything as it goes in and out of my business. That's much more accurate than just a guess at the end of the period. One of the things specifically that a periodic system leaves out is what we call shrinkage. Shrinkage is things that get stolen or spoiled or misplaced or lost or whatever over the course of the period. Now, if I'm doing a perpetual system and I know what cost of goods sold should be and I know what inventory should be, then if I do inventory and there's a difference, I know I've been robbed or I know things have been spoiled or whatever. And I can record that as a loss, as shrinkage. In a periodic system, I don't have that option. I recorded all of that, the difference between what I say I should have and what I say I bought and what I have on hand is cost of goods sold. So I lose that ability to keep track of what I'm losing through theft or through spoilage. So it's a much better system to use perpetual if you can. And nowadays, most companies do use a perpetual system because computers make it relatively simple to keep track of inventory as you scan it in and then scan it out. Usually, periodic systems are for smaller businesses or for businesses that have some other problem, difficulty that keep them from wanting to scan it. It's hard to scan a building, for example. So anyway, most of the time what we see is just small businesses that don't have the computer power using a perpetual system. But for those companies that don't, we have to do not really a closing entry, it's kind of a pseudo closing entry. closing entry is where we close all of our short-term accounts back into retained earnings and back into equity. We talked about that breakdown of equity. We close them all back into an equity account, retained earnings. In a periodic system, though, before we can even do a financial statement, we have to know what cost of goods sold is. Now, since most companies do use a perpetual system, it's not as common anymore to have to go through this process before you do your financial statements. But we still need to know it for two reasons. One, there are still those smaller companies out there that are using a periodic system. Number two, well, we use a lot of shortcuts that are based on the equation that we're about to learn. So you might as well learn it so that you can use those shortcuts. So, what is this process? Well, the process is basically taking all those purchases accounts that you use to keep track of the stuff you bought and collapsing them into inventory so that you can then collapse it into cost of goods sold or calculate cost of goods sold. And that's the process that we need to talk about. And it's not really a closing entry because it's not happening at the end of the period. It's happening after the adjusting entries but before the closing entries. So it's kind of a preliminary closing entry is probably the best way to think about it. Once we've got that number, we keep cost of goods sold open and we use it through making the financial statements and close it out with the rest of the expenses later. If some of that talk about closing didn't quite make sense, don't worry about it. We'll get to closing in a little while. All right, so let's talk about the process then of calculating cost of goods sold. Step number one is to close the purchases accounts. So we haven't kept track of things in inventory as we bought them. Instead, we use separate accounts. So we have a purchases account, a purchases returns and allowances, meaning a return meaning I got it and I sent it back, an allowance meaning I got it, it was broken, and we started to send it back, and our vendor said, wait, what if we knock 10% off? Will you keep it? Yeah, for 10% off, I'll keep it. That's an allowance. When you get that kind of a discount. The other thing we get are discounts where they say, hey, if you pay early, we'll knock some off the price, and we keep track of that as well. So we're going to take all of those different accounts, each one separate. We're going to close those into inventory now at the end of the period. Then we'll close freight in. That's what we spend shipping this inventory from the vendor to our warehouse or our store. And a lot of vendors nowadays, they pay for that for us, but it still happens where we pay the shipping charges. So if we've had any, we close them and make them part of inventory. Then we do inventory, take our ending inventory number, and subtract that from our cost of goods available for sale. Now, cost of goods available for sale, that's what we had in inventory, all of that beginning stuff that was on our shelves when the period began, plus the net purchases, what we bought over the course of the period to put on our shelves. And then that gives us our cost of goods available for sale. From that, what's available to be sold, we subtract what's in ending inventory or still there, and that becomes our COGS, right? Our cost of goods that we actually sold. And so you get equations. Let me put these steps up. I got a little behind. Forgive me. Here's our step of closing freight in. Here's the step then of subtracting ending inventory. And down at the bottom, we have our equations. So we take our cost of goods available for sale, what we have had at any time in the building, minus what we've still got, and that must be what we sold under that periodic assumption. Or if we break it down, all of this is cost of goods available for sale, right? Beginning inventory plus purchases, minus the returns and allowances, minus the discounts, and then plus whatever we paid to get it in the door. So that's our equation to get cost of goods sold, which is the number that we need for our financial statements. So here's our example of inventory. And we'll do this without numbers first. So here's what happens in a periodic system. We have a beginning inventory. It's an asset, so we start with a debit. This is whatever we had in our store or our warehouse when the period began. Then over the course of the period, we have this little purchases account. And as we buy stuff, we keep track of all those purchases. And at the end of the year, after we do our adjusting entries and our adjusted trial balance, we calculate what are in our purchases. And then we close it. And the way you close an account is you just make it a zero balance. So if this is worth X and I subtract X, then that goes to zero. Now for every credit, we have to have a debit. And there it is. There's our debit. So we put that into inventory. Over the course of the period, we've also kept track of what we call our purchase discounts. These are the discounts on our purchases, another clever accounting name. And again, anytime our clients say, hey, if you pay early, we'll knock a little off your price, we keep track of that. And we add it up. And at the end of the period, we say, okay, we're going to take that out of there so that it goes to zero. Credit minus the debit gives us zero. There's a credit. Excuse me, there's a debit here, so I have to have a credit over there. Same thing happens with purchase, returns, and allowances. Anything we've sent back, any kind of extra they give to us to have us keep stuff that maybe wasn't quite right. That'll be Z. Again, we close that out to zero. That's a debit. I need a credit. That's a closing entry, where I credit here and debit there, and I make this go to zero. I've closed it and put it into a permanent account inventory. Last one is our freight in, and I keep track of everything I pay on all of my shipments that I've had to pay for, and we'll call that A because I got to the end of the alphabet. Again, I close it out, so that goes to zero. I've got a credit here, so I need a debit there. And now we get to the end of the period, and we get to the end of the period so that we can do our financial statements. What we do is we add all this up. So we take beginning inventory plus the purchases plus the freight in minus the discounts minus the returns and allowances, and I get my cost of goods available for sale. Then I go and I do inventory and I calculate my ending inventory balance. So I know now a beginning amount. I know an ending amount. No more additions. Using that equation we learned a few sections ago, I can calculate my cost of goods sold. So at the end of the period, all of these accounts, this one, and this one, they've all gone to zero, and only an inventory balance remains. I credit here. I debit cost of goods sold for this amount, and that's what I report on my income statement. So this gives you an idea, I think, of what a closing entry is going to look like. We'll get there, all the closing entries later. It also gives you a feel for what we're doing as far as finding cost of goods sold using that equation that we did. Isn't that exciting? It's cool, isn't it, the way that this all fits together? I think it's cool. It makes sense to me. Anyway, we're going to stop there. We're going to come back in the next segment and run through an example of this cost of goods sold calculation, and hopefully it'll make a lot more sense. Hopefully it makes sense now, but it should make a lot more sense once we've done a full-blown example with numbers and everything. We'll see you in a few minutes.